forgot all about it, didn't you?
Okay, Daddy.
Just kind of marshmallows.
Marshmallows are for little girls.
Fire.
Yeah. I love the sound of a crackling fire.
Got some ice cream. Got some work. Right away, quite a world sound asleep. Too afraid of what might show up while you're dreaming. Nobody sees you. Nobody will believe you. Every day you try to pick up all the pieces. All the memories that somehow never leave you. Nobody sees you. Nobody will believe you. God only knows what you've been through. God only knows what they say about you. God only knows how it's killing you. But there's a kind of love that God only knows. Okay, we're going to start by prayer. Thanks, everybody, for coming out. And we got a fire roaring over here. We got people out there social distancing in their cars. And it looks cold, but it's actually pretty cold. Let's go to the throne. Thank you, Lord, for this time. We're going to talk about hope today. Not hope like the world sees hope, but Christian hope. Hope in you and what that provides and what that means and what we should be doing, Lord. I pray that you speak through me and that we can all, it says your word doesn't go out void. It goes out and has a purpose and it serves it. So we pray that we are obedient to your word and just live lives that glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to talk about hope. I asked my wife on the couch today, I said, what is Christian hope to you? What does that mean? Remember, Ray, I said, remember this so you can tell me what you said. What did you say?
Knowing that God will take care of us as he sees fit.
So my wife is so smart. So she says Christian hope is knowing that God is going to take care of us as he sees fit. Okay? That might mean when the rubber hits the road, there might be some tribulation. There might be some pain. There might be blessings. However he sees fit. And she said after that, she tagged on to that. And we need to be obedient to that, right?
Surrender
to that. So hope for the Christian is hope in God, letting God do what God does and us being surrendered and obedient to it. So the world looks at hope like, man, I hope it doesn't rain on the parade or our wedding. Or they say, I hope I get a new football for Christmas. You know, that's hope that might not come to pass. That's wishing. The Christian hope is firm and steadfast. It is absolute. So we're going to talk about hope today. We're going to talk about find it, live it, and share it. How do we find hope? How do we live out hope? And how do we share hope? So let's proceed. So this is 1 Peter. We're going to do 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. So Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect, exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in the sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood. Okay, there's a lot there. You can't see it, but I got this part highlighted. He's writing this letter to the elect, to the saved, to the believers who are exiles of the dispersion. They've been dispersed. They've been spread out. Okay, let's plug this in to current days. So they are being persecuted heavily, the early church. The first century church is under attack, okay? And a church has always been under attack because we are in a war, a conflict. There's two sides. God's side in the kingdom of God, in the kingdom of darkness, in Satan's side. And all who do not follow God are following Satan, whether they are doing it unwillingly or unknowingly or not. So Peter is writing to believers. So if you're a believer, you can lay claim to these things. If you're not a believer, you can recognize that I don't have these. I can't have that Christian hope, which is sure and absolute expectation. Now, something else you want to keep in mind, we're going to talk a little bit later. Hope and wait are the same word in Hebrew. Okay, we'll get to that. So waiting and hoping, those go hand in hand. And you see a lot in the Bible about waiting on the Lord, waiting patiently. Those who wait upon the Lord will rise up. You know, strength, wings of eagles. And it talks about even the young will get weary and faint. But those who trust in the Lord, wait upon him. So that's where our hope is. Our hope is in God and things happening according to his will. So that might not always look sunny to us. Right now, look around. I was going to say there might come a day where the Christian church, contemporarily speaking, is persecuted. But we're in the United States of America. We don't see persecution on the physical level, bringing imprisonment, separation from family, death. That's going on all around the world. Right now, we're fortunate enough in the United States of America where we don't see the physical, but we're starting to see it a little bit. We're starting to see things coming upon the earth. Now look, people have been saying Christ is coming back for a long time. And it is closer every day. And that's good to say that. And it's okay to say that, yes, the end is near. Because ever since Christ rose from the dead, the clock has started. This clock for the end times of his second coming is ticking away. The angels don't know. He says it's not given to the Son to know. Only the Father knows when he's going to bring this stuff to fulfillment. So Peter is writing to these exiles, these people who are dispersed. So we are in exile right now because of a virus. You know, there's going to come a time where the church might be tried to be stamped out altogether, and it will be. Do you know there's going to come a time where they're going to get rid of all world religions and they're going to unify? That means Christianity gone. Any other religion gone. And they're going to unify under one world religion, which will be ran by the Antichrist. And all the economic systems are going to be one. And everything is going to be unified. But it's going to be a civilization and society that is ruled by the devil. And we very well could be entering these really fast. You know, picture yourself in a river that's going just meandering. Okay? We're going towards the second coming of Christ. The end of all things. This age. Where Jesus is going to come back, usher in his kingdom, and then there's going to be the final judgment where those who denied God go to hell forever, and those who embrace God go to heaven forever. So we're in that river, and we're meandering along in our tube. But imagine this could be the time where the current starts to pick up, and our tube is going a little faster towards that end, and now we're coming into rapids. We're in times right now where this is strange days. You know, the Ignite 365 outreach, our ministry is banned from doing Facebook Live. And the only thing I can think of is we talk about being against abortion and we talk about living a life that glorifies God. And we're just preaching the Bible. And that's the persecution we face, though, where people gun us down and say we're dumb and stupid and bigots and the exclusivity of Christ is offensive. And all this stuff. So that's the persecution we're facing. It's verbal. It's shutting us down. But there's going to come a time where we might be hunted. You know, we're outside right now, and it's cold. There might be a day where the church building has been burned down, and Christians are going to get arrested and thrown in prison if they are gathering. And we might have to be out in the woods somewhere, hike out miles and miles into the woods and have a fire. And be bringing the word, because the word can't stop. That is, the church is the spiritual hospital. The gathering of the body is where we grow and get our spiritual strength and go out into this world. So the hope of Jesus, the hope we have as a Christian, to find it, to live it, and to share it, it's why we are here. It's why we have small groups. It's why we have prayer meetings. We are getting equipped, not so that we can answer all the questions in the Bible category on Jeopardy, not so we can win a pie and trivial pursuit in the religion category. We're here to grow in knowledge and strength spiritually so that we can go out and share it with the lost world. And not everybody's going to take to it. Not everybody's going to be appreciative of it, but there are those out there who will. If you don't think evangelism is important, look during the tribulation, when the stuff is really getting heavy and the persecution is really coming against the church and the Antichrist is on the scene, God sends two witnesses down, and they're here for years proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ, and nobody can kill them. You know what? There's going to be an angel that is flying throughout the earth talking, preaching the everlasting gospel. Do you know how mad the Antichrist is going to be? Do you know how mad the secular governments are going to be that this angel won't shut up and he's pronouncing woe on the earth and about receiving the eternal gospel? Imagine that. They're going to have surface-to-air missiles trying to take this angel out. They're going to be doing everything in their power until they find out, okay, this we can't do anything about that. The witnesses can't be killed until God allows it. There's going to be 144,000 from each tribe, 12,000 from each tribe of Israel that are going to be sealed, that are going to be going around the earth proclaiming the eternal gospel. People will receive it. People will deny it. That's the way it always is. We don't know that. God gives that to the Spirit to draw, but we're required to go out and to proclaim it. So that's why we need to gather, whether it be in cars, whether it be via Facebook. We need to stop. We can't stop feeding on the Word of God and then living it out to His glory. So these guys are in exile. They're hiding in caves. That's where they're having their meetings, in the catacombs, these caves and ruins under the city. And Peter's writing to them, and he's saying, look, God foreknew this. It's the foreknowledge of God. God knew all this was going to go on, and God knows what He's put in you. He hasn't put in you some second-rate power. He's put His very own Spirit in you. He knows you're elect. He knows you're His, and He's equipping us, okay? So we find it. Let's go on. Where do we find this hope? Okay, this is the next verse in Peter 1. It says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to His great mercy, He has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So there's our hope. The living hope, not just hope. It's a hope that is alive through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He paid it all on the cross, and He rose from the dead victorious. And that is our guarantee, the Holy Spirit in us, and His resurrection is the firstborn from the dead, that we also will be raised from the dead eternally. And we will be with Him forever. So that's our hope. And this, again, it's not a hope of, I hope we get a snow day tomorrow because I didn't study for the exam. That's wishful thinking. This is sure and absolute expectation. A living hope. So here's the way I look at it. You want to define living hope. What does that mean to have a living hope in Jesus Christ? A living hope equals to be activated and energized. Who here has ever worked at a factory where they have lockout, takeout procedures? Okay? You got to go work on a mill machine, okay? And this mill machine takes, this robot picks up these big chunks. Well, at this one place I worked at in Barberton, they took big chunks of aluminum and they put it into this machine, and it was like handlebars, like you're riding a motorcycle, and you took the handlebars, and they grabbed this big chunk of aluminum, and it put it in this mill, and then it started milling it, and it milled out a big a rim for semis, Alcoa rims, okay? But if somebody had to work on that, maintenance had to work on it, they had to make sure that the energy supply was shut off. So you can't just go and shut off the machine, and you can't, because there's still power coming to the machine, even though you've cut it off and something could go wrong. You got to cut off all power to this machine. So you go to the main box where the power comes in and you shut that off. And then you put your lock on it with your name, that you only have the key for it. So you can't start that power back up. And then you drain the power that's in the machine in case there's any stored energy in there. And you drain that. So all the power's out. Okay, that is the world's hope. They don't have a hope that is sure, absolute, firm, steadfast, that is not going to waver, that's not going to be, shoot, I really hoped I was going to go to heaven forever. No, it's absolutely going to happen because you're secure in God. But the world doesn't have that. They're like that locked out, tagged out machine. All their energy is not at their disposal. But you throw them switches back on, now that machine is energized. Now it is active. That's what that living hope. We are energized and we are active. So that means we are living it out. Find it, live it, share it. That's what we're doing with this hope. So it says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to His great mercy, He has caused us to be born again. So we were dead. We were deactivated, de-energized. But now we are born again. And some translations say we are regenerated to a living hope. So now we are active and energized. And there's an inheritance, verse 4 of 1 Peter. There's an inheritance kept in heaven for you. So we have to remember that. We are pilgrims in this place. We are aliens. This isn't our home. We're here on a mission. We're here to do something. And that is to enjoy God, glorify God, but ultimately we're going to enjoy God in heaven forever. So, but our blessings are right now on this earth. We're here to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. And that is the hope in us. Our hope, faith, love. All these things work to be glorifying God, to be the light in a dark world. So the word wait comes from the Hebrew word kaveh. Q-A-V-A-H. So that Hebrew word kaveh also means to wait, hope for, look, and to expect. So we look at our words, wait and hope, as two different words in the English, but they're one word in the Hebrew, kaveh. So waiting is also hoping, longing for, expecting. So if you've ever looked at it, now I got this up here because I was going to have it on the screen so you guys could see, but on the oil bottles for engine oil, it says SAE on there. It's a term for engineering. But SAE, this is why I like to think about it. How do we know our hope is secure in Christ? Okay, I think like this. SAE, sure and absolute expectation. That what God has promised is going to come to pass. The gifts, the blessings, the promises of Christ in Christ, through Christ to us, are sure and absolute. It's an expectation that will come to pass. So I like to think of SAE, oil. Because when you think of the Holy Spirit, a lot of times in the Bible, oil, olive oil, is representative of the Spirit of God. So I like to think of that. Okay, the Holy Spirit is our guarantee. It is our safeguard. It is the fact that God is going to do what He says He does. He even gave us His Spirit. Okay, we're alive. And we have the Spirit of God living in us. That's that oil. That's the Holy Spirit. So we can't forget. Here's what Paul says in Ephesians 3, 20 and 21. He's talking, he's giving praise to God. And he says, now to Him, that's God, who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to His power that is at work within us. To Him be glory. Okay? That machine that is not locked out and tagged out anymore, that machine is operating by power. Okay? We are operating by power, but it says it is God's power that is at work within us. So, we are energized and activated and powered by God. The world is not. The world is under deception. The world is blind. That's why when I had a friend from high school says, why do you always talk about this and talk about abortion and talk about it? And it's like, look, man, these are moral things that are important. A country, a nation, a world that doesn't value life, they're hellbound. There's no moral absolutes there. There's no holy, righteous truth to live on. So that's a fundamental practice that is ungodly and pagan and will be condemned. So these are important things I talk about. But the world looks at it as offensive. And stop. Who gives you the right to say that? Well, God gives us the right. We're supposed to go to those. Do you know the letter 1 Corinthians? Paul wrote that letter to the church and addressed all the stuff that was going on and how to fix it and what they should do. Apostle Paul confronted their wrongs, their sins. And that's what you're supposed to do in love. And then his other letters, he's saying, man, you're making good progress. That's awesome. That's what we're supposed to be doing. We're not supposed to put our heads in the sand and turn a blind eye to injustice, to immorality, to people being anti-God. We're supposed to be representatives of the kingdom of heaven. But remember, it's not our power. We're not doing this in our own strength. It says it is the power of God that works in us. So what's the Christian hope? As a believer, what can you rest assured in, Rachel? Yes. You have no more dread of God or terror of past sin. You've been forgiven of that. Okay, not because you reached, you know, you hit the bell on the thing with the hammer and get a cigar, and God says, okay, you don't have to worry about my dread anymore or fear of my wrath because you've been so good. No, you hit that bell with the blood of Jesus. That ding, and says, here you go, have eternal life. Not a cigar, was from the blood of Jesus. So as a Christian, we have that sure and absolute expectation of living with God forever, glorifying and loving God in that relationship. We have no more terror of our past sin. The world is under condemnation. The world is under judgment. The world is going to fall into the hands of a wrathful God. We also, what else do we have as Christians with the Christian hope? We have rest concerning all fears as to the future. Like my wife said at the beginning, hope is to trust that God is going to do for you how he sees it. Now, what better way to live a life to say, God, your will be done in my life? What my Amen, yeah, hallelujah. Thank you for that hallelujah honk. My mother-in-law said the other night, you're always trying to do things your way. And I had to, okay, you're right. I get ahead of myself and I try to do this. Okay, I got to do this. We'll have this small group and we'll do this. And I you never see like cartoons where the dog's reading the book and the cat's trying to look and see, and the dog turns it this way. And he won't let the cat see what he's reading, and he turns it this way. I forget it, Tom and Jerry, it was funny. But he wouldn't let him see the book, and he kept trying to see, and he kept moving it. That's what I feel like I do to God sometimes. I got a plan going, and God's like, okay, let me get in this. And I'm like, sheet, and I turn the book over. And he comes over to this side and says, all right, let me get in this. Here's what I think, and I turn the book this way. We got to let God be God. We got to be surrendered. And I'm the first one to say, I got to be more surrendered. Can you ever be enough surrendered? Surrender is not a half measure. You can't be half surrendered. You have to be fully surrendered. At Appomattox Courthouse, when Grant and Lee got together, Grant didn't say, okay, you guys go back. We're going to stop the war. You guys can keep slaves that are, you know, adult males. You got to get rid of your women and children slaves. No, it was absolute unconditional surrender. Total removal of slaves, done. Total surrender of conflict and active war waging against the North, done. It was absolute and total surrender. So we can't surrender our lives and be in a state of surrender and then do it half measures. It's got to be full committed surrender. And I'll be the first to tell you, every time we sin, we've come out of that surrendering. So it's not something that we can do alone. We need the grace of God and the power of the Holy Spirit, and we're still going to mess up. But we have a loving God who knows our frailties, and he helps us back up. And he says, try again. You can get this. We have a God of encouragement, not of a God of belittling and begrudging. If he didn't think we are valuable enough to put his spirit in or send his son to die for us, think about how valuable we are. He sent his son to die. He gives us his spirit. We are of priceless valuability to God, and he's going to make sure that he's for us and behind us. So that's something too. Can I get a hallelujah honk? Yeah. Okay, the Christian hope. Okay, the Christian hope. Thank you. The absolute certainty of life eternal with God. That is something to be happy about. Okay, I'm going to go through persecution. Okay, I might get burned at the stake. Okay, but I don't have to worry about dreading God because I know he's got me. And I don't have to worry about my future because I know it's in God and eternal. So whatever they do in my body, it doesn't matter. I'm secure in God. And there's a world out there that's full of fear. You know, I've seen the suicide rate since this coronavirus has swept the world has gone up. People don't see hope in the secular view, the humanistic view, the not following God view. They don't see hope. They don't see that sure and absolute expectation that God is going to deliver on what he said. They see nothing but dread and doom. And I've seen alcohol sales have like booming. They're up like over 55% since this lockdown. Okay, so people are social distancing and they're drowning their fears that are rising up because this is uncertain times. And look, there's going to be darker days and more stranger days and more terrorizing days for believers coming ahead. And that's even the more so where we put our trust in God and stay there firmly. So hope, how do we find it? There was a lady named Hannah in the Bible, and she was barren. She couldn't have any children. And there wasn't medical procedures back then where they could give her fertility drugs, or they could do this or do that, and she might have a child. She was barren, and it was considered like a curse from God back then, that people go, you don't have any heritage coming down, nobody coming behind you, nobody to help you out to work on the land and the farm and the house. You are just despised by God, they would say. You are cursed, and this is from God, for whatever past sins and whatever they would say that her family did or why she was in this position. But Hannah, she had hope. What did she do? Did she call up the Mayo Clinic? Did she call the pagan shaman over to pray for a baby? Did she write letters to the storks to see if they could deliver something? No, it says she prayed to God. And she said, Lord, if you give me a child, I will dedicate him all his life to you. So in a hopeless situation where the world doesn't see hope, Hannah says, I'm going to take it to God. I'm going to allow God's will to be done. I'm going to put it there. I'm going to say, God, your will be done. You know what I want. I want a child. I pray you give me one. And look, if you do, Lord, I'm going to dedicate him to you all his life. And she found it. She found hope. Not the maybe, not the wishful thinking, but that sure and absolute expectation. And she became pregnant. And she had a son named Samuel and dedicated him to God. And it says here in 1 Samuel 2:1, and Hannah prayed and said, my heart rejoices in the Lord. My horn is exalted in the Lord. I smile at my enemies because I rejoice in your salvation. So when the world comes at you, you don't have to get scared. You don't have to get intimidated. You remember that your salvation is in God. You can smile in the face of your enemies, and you are exalting God. She found hope in God. That's where our hope rests. The resurrection of Christ, the gift of the Holy Spirit, the promises of the Bible. That's our hope. She found hope. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they lived hope. Okay, imagine we are facing persecution. And they're going to say, okay, it is now not just a hate crime to preach Christianity, because Christianity says stuff we don't agree with. So not only is it a hate crime to preach Christianity, it's also punishable by death. Okay, there's going to come a day where that may happen. And it already happens throughout the world. Let me repeat that. There is going to come a day where that will happen in this country, because it's already a death sentence in a lot of countries. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had that death sentence. It says, if you don't bow to this idol, if you don't bow and worship me, you're dead. They lived out their faith because their hope was in Christ. Hannah found her hope in God. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego lived out their hope in God. And he says, wait. Get something straight here, King. Our God can save us if he wants to. We don't know what God's got going on in mind. We even prayed as a group together and said, God, your will be done. So whatever happens to us, God's got us. In the midst of the fire or out of the fire. But either way, we're not bowing down to your ungodly laws, your ungodly rules, your ungodly recommendations, your ungodly orders. We're going to bow down to God only and follow him. They lived out their hope. We need to live out our hope. Amen. Talks about the Spirit of Christ being in the Old Testament prophets. He talks about Christ spoke to the Old Testament prophets. They were moved by the Holy Spirit. The words the prophets spoke were not their own words. They were not men. Words of men and men of wisdom of men. They were God's words. Peter says that Christ spoke, his spirit were in these prophets. And the same with Noah. Noah was called a preacher of righteousness. Noah's day was so wicked. Rachel, say how wicked was it?
How wicked was it?
How wicked was it that only people thought about sin continuously all the time? That's all they thought about, was sinning and doing sin and how they can sin more and how they could have sin abound on a daily basis. And when they went to bed, they wanted to dream about sin and they wanted to commit evil in their dreams so that they were sinning all the time. That's what it says. They only did evil all the time. Well, righteousness was Noah's pedigree. He was a righteous because of his faith in God. He was a preacher of righteousness. And for those hundreds of years, that 100 years, while he's building the ark, he's living in persecution. Just like the church is living in persecution today. Do you know no one ever talks about this religion doing this or this religion doing that? It's only about the cross of Christ that people get take offense at. It's only about the Ten Commandments that people take offense at. The name of Jesus, people take offense at. Because that is the one under attack. The true God is under attack by the true enemy of God, Satan. So, just like Noah was under attack as he's preaching righteousness and saying, look, you all need to get right with God. You're living against God. It's not that you're not caring about God. You are in active combat against God. And he preached that righteousness. He was sharing the righteousness that he had. His hope, he shared it with those around him. And guess what? None of them responded. How many you think there might be a fraction, even 1% of the world that heard Noah would respond? None responded. That's how enticing evil is. That's how deceiving the devil is. Even though you think you're doing right sometimes, death lies at the door and you're doing evil. But Noah preached to them and their condemnation was just. And then the flood came. So Hannah found hope. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego lived hope. Noah shared hope. So up here you see a map of the Battle of Gettysburg. And I want you to know that Christian hope is active. We already know we're energized by God. We have a living hope, so we know it's alive and active. So our hope is active. It's not something we are just waiting for. So it's a battle of Gettysburg. They're coming at each other from all sides. In any battle, I just picked the Battle of Gettysburg. There's one side raging war against another side. It is a conflict. Okay, we are in a conflict. So, I really wish you could see the slides. The first one is a godly you. So picture yourself. You're in combat. You have your marching orders from God as an ambassador of the kingdom of heaven, fully equipped with the Holy Spirit, and you are godly you. Well, your godly you needs to be in the universe of your family. Your godly you is now in a godly family. And you all are a godly family now. And this godly family is now going into the universe of the community. So now the single you has now become the family. And now the family that is godly is now impacting the community in which they live in. So we're sharing the gospel. We're proclaiming Jesus. We're living it. Sometimes you are the gospel of Christ just by how you walk and talk and act. So we're living it. So we are that single person who's living a godly life, now in a family of godly people who are now in a godly community. Guess what's just next? A godly nation. So now the communities and the neighborhoods of the nation are now sharing. They're now evangelizing so that we become a godly nation. This is called going back to God. This is what Jonah went to Nineveh and says, you all need to get right with God. You got 40 days to get it together, to start treating God like God, to get away from all this idolatry, to get away from all this evilness, to get away from this satanic system of which you are perpetrating and living in and glorifying, and get back to God. Jonah says, you got 40 days. And they responded. And the king says, y'all, listen up. We're repenting, we're praying, we're asking forgiveness, we're not eating, we're going to fast, we're not going to eat anything, drink anything. Get them cows, get that water trough away from them cows, get that hay away from the cows, they're fasting too. Get the water and get the sackcloth and get the ashes and get them cows dressed in mourning because we're going to mourn over our sin. That's what God wants a godly person to become in a godly family, in a godly community, in the neighborhoods, making a godly nation. Come back to me. And then a godly world. You know what? I know how it ends. The world doesn't respond very good. The world in its entirety does not heed the call of repentance and turning to God. The majority of the world shakes their fists at God. And during the tribulation, he releases all these judgments upon the earth. And many people die. But in these judgments, there's grace. He's saying, all right, I'm turning it up. I'm going to ratchet up the judgment, and I want you to come to me. And then people will still not come to him. They'd rather hide under the rocks of the mountains than look at God and repent. So, this is what we need to do. Christian hope is active. We need to be the light of Christ, the beacon in our families, in our neighborhoods. It needs to be a lifestyle. So, ROI. Does anybody know what that means? ROI. Return on investment. Okay? I don't know what that means either, because I don't ever do any investing financially. Because the first step of financially investing is to have finances. Okay? So, hey! Here's a question I want to leave you with. We have this hope in Christ. We found the hope. We need to live the hope and share the hope. So, is God getting a return on his investment in you? He's invested a lot in us. The death of his son is an investment of the highest order. The Holy Spirit indwelling us and empowering us in his investment. Okay? Ask yourself, is God getting his return on you? And as I end, just to let you guys know, we've got something coming up in June. We're going to be doing a Revelation study where we're going to go verse by verse, chapter by chapter through the book of Revelation. We don't know what day it's going to be on. We're still going to be doing the social distancing thing. We'll probably have a fire, and hopefully in June it's warm out. We'll have a fire, we'll have some lawn chairs out, and we'll just get together and we'll go through the book of Revelation. And there's also going to be an equipping and energizing evangelism explosion coming up. It's going to be a one-day thing. I'm going to get different pastors and different people who want to talk. We're going to do like 5-10 minute snippets. We're going to talk up. We're going to talk about evangelizing. We're going to talk about equipping and sharing so that we can be going out wherever we are. You know, it doesn't have to be intentional. I'm going to go find homeless people today and proclaim the gospel. Okay, it doesn't have to be intentional. But as you live your life out, there will always be opportunities to evangelize. So we're going to talk about that, how to evangelize in your everyday. So I had a guy at work the other day. He said, man, why don't you pray for everybody during the meetings? Okay, we have meetings on Tuesdays and Thursdays before work starts to see what's going on, where we're at, what we're doing. And he's like, why don't you pray, you know, for the coronavirus, for Just the stuff going through this disease, and it's so dangerous here at work with the cranes and the forklifts and the this and the that, just for safety. So he challenged me. Why don't you pray? And I know there's going to be opposition to that. And I think I need to respect my boss and ask him ahead of time if I can do that. But this is an opportunity that I've missed. And even if we say, let's go outside at break time, and anybody wants to pray, we'll pray at break time. So we don't have to interfere with work time or other people. But there's always times. Even when you think you've done it all, which I don't think I've done all the evangelism routes you can do. I know I got a lot to go. But even when you think, man, there's nothing I can do here or in this situation, there's always opportunities, and you can always pray on behalf of people and for people and intercede on behalf of them to the kingdom of God. So I'm going to end in prayer. Remember, our hope is active. It's living. We are energized by the God, and we have a sure and absolute expectation that the promises of his holy word are true, steadfast, and eternal. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the hope that's in us. We know that we don't have to dread judgment. We know that you are a friend of ours. We are in relationship as your children. And like my daughter, right before the sermon started, cut her head and it was bleeding everywhere. And my wife swooped in with her motherly instinct and cradled her up and covered the wound. That's what you do, Lord. We are children to you. You have a heart for us. You don't want nothing bad. You don't want us to be hurt. You have the greatest. You know, you have a purpose for us that is beyond our comprehension and a love. Let's just leave it there. We need to understand that. Our hope is in you being the best intended person for our lives. And what better place to leave our lives but in your hands? All glory to you, Father. We love you, praise you, and give you all honor in Jesus' name. Amen.
Are you potty trained yet?
Did you brought her potty?
Are you doing it right now?